Good evening, residents of Sunderland. This is a regularly scheduled meeting of the Sunderland Board of Selectmen. Today's date is June 6th, year 2016. Called order 6:37. We have a new in-training director, producer, writer, puppeteer in the back of the room. So we're reviewing the procedures. He has promised he's going to make an action show intro for us. We've been waiting now for a few years to mimic the ones that have been done in Hadley. David has already started his rappelling off of Mount Sugar. So stay tuned for that. David will be rappelling. I think Scott is pushing. And
I'm going to do the
Sherry
whole.
You'll be at the bottom. Make sure we all are okay.
Absolutely.
We had to scrap the whole sliding over the hood, you know, on our way to the meeting thing. It just didn't work.
No. Okay. So first thing up is, you know, Bobby Hearn was a chief for that fire department for how many years? We got to see him, what, maybe once every couple or 2 years. Steve, I think Stevie likes this. I think he likes the limelight. Mr. Benjamin?
I try not to have too much of it. But you can get a little exposure now.
So we have Steve Benjamin here tonight. He's going to talk to us about the MACC, which is a designated multi-agency coordination center. Shoot, Stevie.
All right. Thank you very much for having us here this evening. Get with me, Dan Nietzsche from the County of Governments. And I don't want to steal his thunder, but what we've got is an opportunity to get involved in a program that will benefit us in the time of a big emergency, help take some of the weight off, and also give us a little bit of a louder voice in the greater clamor for resources and people and so forth. And it was presented to me at a fire chief's meeting a couple of months ago, and I thought that it would be beneficial to us. Dan said that he was going to contact each municipality and gauge their interests, so I tried to break a little bit of ice to start with, and he's here this evening to give all the details, answer questions, and really give us a rollout of what's available and how it's going to present itself.
Good. Thank you, Steve.
Without further ado.
Sure. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you for having me. I'm not sure if you have the presentation copies.
Can you put this in?
Yeah.
We'll take one. Thanks. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So as the chief said, basically how this came about was after Tropical Storm Irene, there was an after action review done throughout the state and in particular Franklin County. And one of those action items that came out of it was to create a multi-agency coordination center. And what that basically is an organization, a center, that can coordinate and assist response and recovery activities during large events, incidents, both planned, if you're having a large event, and not so planned, such as hurricanes and tornadoes and all that nasty stuff we hear about. Just quickly hitting on some highlights, you guys can read the presentation at your leisure. There's no cost currently. I don't see a cost coming forward in the foreseeable future. And what I mean by no cost is there's no cost to join and there's no cost to use. All the personnel that are going to be manning it are all volunteer. Right now we have a commitment from the Northwest Massachusetts Incident Management Team to start us off with that level of commitment. And then as we move forward, we're going to be gaining volunteers to augment their staff so that we have more people on our roll. The MAC is going to do a couple of things. You're going to be able to call on the MAC, the personnel on the MAC, to assist your emergency management professionals in really any duty, whether it be you need a public information officer, you need help with situational awareness, you need to know some situational awareness. You want to know what's going on in the communities around you. All of that information can be found out through the MAC. The MAC is going to be available, if you choose it to be, as a liaison with MEMA, so that if you're in a pinch, you don't have a lot of people, you're putting in a lot of resource requests, you can call the MAC, say this is what we need, work with MEMA to see about getting it. And you don't need to, whoever is manning that, whoever's the incident commander, doesn't need to have to worry about making those calls back to MEMA or checking in on MEMA about the status of the equipment or the assets. It's really, I can't stress this enough, it's really an extension of your own town, emergency management people. And I, as someone that came from MEMA and worked with MACs in other parts of the state, I can't tell you how invaluable that is, especially the one that I've worked with mostly is down in Barstool County on the Cape. And they do a great job remodeling some of them, remodeling some of our own. There's been a phase one out in Berkshire County, and they're doing great. North Adams is really taking off with the MAC concept, and he's doing a lot of great work out there. Phase two is Franklin County. And then hopefully we'll move forward with some other counties developing the same concept. So eventually there'll be MACs throughout the state in some form or another to kind of help coordinate this response. And and also recovery. I don't know if you've ever dealt with FEMA and the paperwork deluge that they bring along with them, but certainly the MAC will be able to help you with recovery operations also.
Good. My only concern is when we go to a larger group like this is that sometimes the smaller towns get lost in the shuffle. I would say the last hurricane or weather event, snowstorm that we had was a prime example. A lot of the Franklin County resources went towards the western part of Franklin County in the beginning, and we were doing a lot on our own. So we were making, and we probably got better results because of that. And I mean, just our fire chief and police chief, they're making calls all over the place, as we were also. So sometimes I do wonder, when you get to a big thing, would it be more apt to serve as Greenfield or Deerfield instead of Sunderland? And I haven't seen the commitment to service Sunderland as well as Greenfield.
I'll speak a little bit to that, and I think I know what you mean by the commitment part, but the important thing to remember is when we'd call upon the MAC, we wouldn't be saying, okay, here it is, take over. It's more from a standpoint of, here it is, we need you to do this, this, and this.
Personal, the tasks.
And part of the execution side, there's operations and there's command, and we wouldn't necessarily be turning over command, but we'd be turning over part of the operations. And the incident management team that he mentioned is already in place, and they're already somebody that we would be calling on should the incident be large enough. So I hear what you're saying. Our assertiveness wouldn't necessarily be taken away, but we might have another avenue to get resources. And don't take this the wrong way, but we call you in, we can probably also kick you out, right?
That's exactly true. I mean, you can go, you can...
It's a two-way.
It is. So you can tip your toe into the water, and all you need is one little thing, and, that's it. You guys stay over there, we'll call you again if we need you. Or you can go all in. If you want to call MEMA directly and bypass the MAC, if you were involved with it, not a problem. It's really... just a labor force, a labor pool to draw from, and some experience. A lot of times, I can't tell you how many events I've been a part of, and sometimes just having that advice, that person you can call on, really speeds things up and makes the recovery that much easier and more comfortable for everybody. It's really a knowledge base that you'll be able to call on.
I don't disagree. I'm just saying it'd be interesting to see it actually work.
I suppose. Right.
And that's Well, yeah, and I suppose nobody's hoping for a reason to
see it. Exactly. But, no, we'll start small. Let's start really, really small if we're going to see it work.
Unluckiest enough, yeah. That's even the term, to work through it. But it's a resource.
Absolutely. Scott?
Well, Tom, you know, you talk a little bit about the loss of the local flavor and ownership of response. And I know this first pass is grant driven, and congratulations on, you know, a sizable allocation from the governor. My question about long term funding sources, maybe there's no reason to see it now, but does this become a driver for increased COG costs in the future? Would be a question of mine. $1 million doesn't go as far as it used to.
Right. I wish the $1 million was.
I know. I understand.
Yeah, I really wish. That'd be fun. You know, there's nothing on. I did, when I was doing the budgets for this, that's only one. You're looking at about $1,000 to $2,000, depending on how many events you have per year, sustain this. If those funds weren't able to be allocated through current grants, COG, whatever, I think the pass through, maybe the ask of the towns, again, this is just an ask, would be very minimal. You're looking at $50 to $100 a year, and that's flexible. Where if nothing happens, we don't use any equipment, and we're not thinking along the lines of only charging those that use it, but it would be a yearly
shared cost.
Yeah, shared cost, mm-hmm. as needed only. Mm-hmm. So we're really not looking to pass any. We're certainly not looking to expand, to grow, to get more toys and equipment. We want to keep this as compact and as effective as possible. Low impact, small footprint.
Are you relying more on the existing equipment and the existing towns rather than seeing it as a, sort of an agency with its own equipment base and things like that? Or
actually not. I'm in the current process of purchasing a couple of multiband radios, a really nice copier printer, an office supplies type of situation. I'm gearing it towards having somewhat of a mobile aspect so that this all can fit into containers and move around. So where
the issue is, essentially.
Yeah, yeah. Exactly.
So a mobile command center.
We have a couple of spots that we have commitments with to house us, but if it makes sense to move to certain areas to be a little closer, to if it's only one area being affected, we'll have the ability to move around. Yeah. And we don't have any permanent infrastructure within one building, so that relieves some of the cost, because they're not COG buildings, they're established areas that, you know, we're asking to use their facilities for mm-hmm. a set time.
Follow up, Mr. Chair. So, how does this work inside ICS? Say you've got a multi-town. There's a five-town West County incident, right? ICS structure begins. Where does MAC sit in that?
Could have them do quite a few things. Mm-hmm. It's a versatile organization. They would. From what I've heard so far, they would have the resources to work in either supply, and you're getting down, for things like that, you're getting down really into the roots of ICS.
Oh, I agree. I'm thinking you say there's Chief A and Chief B and Chief C and Chief D and, you know, multi-chiefs, multi-discipline, MAC fits where?
MAC would fit in the, from what I've thought of since I heard the first presentation mm-hmm. and talking to a few other people, it would be in that obtaining resources mm-hmm. cloud.
Okay.
Probably a lot of different things that they'd be able to do, but the forte would be finding things that we need, especially if we don't have the people to make the calls and do all that, and then also from the standpoint of maybe on the financial side, mm-hmm. because there's always that element somewhere over in the margin, right. But it tends to take up a lot of time afterwards.
Sure.
And it's that helping to recover assets mm-hmm. or helping with estimates.
Mm-hmm.
I think they're right.
20 minutes to make a decision on this or this. Right. What's going to be the most advantageous for us when this is over?
Yeah.
If they're both going to do the same thing, what's better for us? So there's some of that. And then I don't see them as somebody that would come in necessarily and take on an operations role, mm-hmm. or any one of the different command segments.
Right.
Not necessarily, because we've got things set up for that.
Yeah.
And people that we know and we can work with.
Nor do I.
Yeah.
Command is not something that the Mac wants to get involved with.
Okay. That makes it a little clearer for me. I'm thinking, you know, where is it a layer? And maybe it sounds more like a broker versus a layer.
A broker, an advisor.
Yep.
Logistics.
Yep.
Somebody that we can...
It was 2.5 years before we got reimbursement for the mountain road work. After and it was no fault of the systems. It was just a lot going on.
That's right.
Okay. Thank you.
That was kind of the question I had, just mechanically how would it work. And when I look through this, it sounds like a great idea on paper, and also it's one of these things that you look back in retrospect and think, dismantling county government was probably a great idea for somebody for their political career, but we're kind of looking and seeing, especially with a lot of these disasters and things like that some aspects of it kind of made sense for certain things.
Mm-hmm.
But I think one thing that might help in this presentation too is, especially if you look back over the last, say, 5 years or so, there's a lot of good examples of disasters that have happened around here, from like the Springfield tornado,
mm-hmm.
the ice storm, things like that. I'd almost throw an example in there, because I imagine you're going to get the same questions, is how is this going to work mechanically? In other words, we've got a tornado that just blew through us over to Deerfield across the river, you know, and sort of put a little example in there of what some things might do, just to help people like visualize, you know, like how it's going to work. Because that's kind of, and sad to say right now, the only way you know really is when you get into it, and unless you had a drill or something, you're just going to have a disaster and see how it works, you know.
Well, actually, it's a good segue into what is drilling and Mac's role. Yeah. And because, you know, a regional perspective, multi-agency coordination center effectively is regional multi-agency. What happens if we're drilling and Heath isn't? Or maybe we're drilling and Heath is and Mac's going to be used. How does it work?
Some of the past meetings that you've had, and talk about some of the bigger drills.
Yeah.
So you're addressing how we would gather multiple communities together for drills?
Yeah.
To be honest with you, we've been so focused on trying to get this off the ground.
Get the rollout complete. Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
But the way that I imagine it, I mean, it's not something that we haven't thought of at all.
Mm-hmm.
We would work to divide up the segments into the mm-hmm. county and not have chunks be drilled.
Mm-hmm.
You would have... different segments, West County, South County, all, so that one side can be the receiving entity and the other side can be the sending,
mm-hmm.
and then you can swap at some point and run through the scenario again or a different scenario and work to learn how the Mac works,
mm-hmm.
and how each community can help each other or how each region can help each other. Because I believe that Penn County is so diverse in geography and in need that there's equipment stashed away different places that you may not necessarily ever think you need. You know, someone, you know, Monroe might have some kind of specialized equipment that suits them only, but then an event happens and you need that equipment.
Sure.
So, makes sense.
This isn't, of course, the home mutual aid concept and the idea of and coordinated agencies isn't new, but this is maybe a little bit more formal mm-hmm. than it would have been should we experience an incident like that.
Yeah.
So a little bit of pre-work perhaps,
mm-hmm.
and not necessarily a completely new idea, but
right.
a more formalized approach to the mutual aid beyond fire, EMS, and police,
mm-hmm.
which
it's
is where
coordinated
it's most commonly practiced.
Good point. Okay. Steve, is there anything else you need for us to do?
No. Appreciate you listening and considering.
All right. Well, we'll hopefully never have to use your services.
I agree.
I wish that won't be the case based on the last 5 years, though. You know?
Exactly.
That's our goal.
Good.
Well, Dan, it was nice meeting you, and thanks for this information.
Steve,
thank you. You're welcome.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thanks. So, Steve, we'll see you in about 2 weeks or so.
Might be sooner.
I know the weather, right?
Let's see.
Thanks, man.
Okay, next up we have Eric Hardy, and he's the new Subway owner. Eric?
A certain spot you'd like me to sit.
Oh, you get the shameless plug
chair. Microphone there.
There you go.
All right, Eric is taking over the Subway that's located across the street from the plaza strip mall that we have. Basic comes in. Basic gone right through everything, right? You got everything that needs to eat the common, did the common Vic. License, the food permit. There's no entertainment.
No entertainment.
No pinball machines.
No jukeboxes.
No alcohol.
Not yet. No special right. spirits.
Okay, good.
So, now this common Vic is going to be for the remainder of this year.
Yes.
For the renewal.
All right. And the food permit also. But you're going to get two hit right away, huh?
I'm sorry?
You're going to get hit right away because with a new...
Yeah, I'm used to it.
All right, so Scott and David, we need a motion on... Scott or David, we need a motion on a common vicular and a food permit.
Motion.
Second for the business name of Stage 2 Subs, LLC, operating the Subway franchise.
Okay. Any discussion? Another chance you get one chance to sell your sub shop. It's an open mic.
You're actually live
tell
right
us
now.
Tell us why we want to go to the Subway that's located on 116 in Sunderland.
Well, I'd first like to thank you all for having me here today. Cindy said I could just say a few words, so I'd like to begin by saying I am fairly new to the town of Sunderland. However, I'm not new to Subway. I've been with Subway for... longer than I thought I would be, which is about 9 years now, three of which I've been an owner. I started the Hatfield shop. I took over the South Deerfield shop on Elm Street, and now I'm here before you today. So that shows you a little bit of, I think, what I'm capable of, and the quality of the products that I really strive to give to the local people. I'm a local guy myself. I live in Hatfield, right over the river, right on Main Street. So, and I really love to meet the people. I love to meet the people of Hatfield, South Deerfield, and now I can't wait to meet some of the people here in Sunderland as well. I'm accepting all coupons. I'm doing promotions, and
actually, that's a good point because sometimes the other place may or may not have accepted all the
correct
coupons. So, right. As well, a franchisee. Prerogative, right?
You're correct. Yes, sir. As a franchisee, we do have some flexibility there as far as promotions, coupons, even pricing is it's kind of up to us. So I'd like to just let the people of Sunderland know that I am honoring those deals, and I really strive for a high quality product, even if it might take a little bit longer. I think to me, I think the quality of the products is the most important thing, and it starts with the bread. So, I've already spoken with a lot of the employees there, and, we're ready to roll, and I can't wait to meet everybody. So, thank you very much for having me.
We wish you luck. I mean, anytime with new business, we like to see the business. I think there's enough business for everyone, so. Because there's a little chunk that's ready for Subway also. But Subway actually has been in town a long time, too.
Yeah, a couple of different locations.
Yes, sir.
Right. That's right. Yeah, they moved.
Yeah, now it looks like it's that cape-looking house across the street from, as you mentioned, the plaza there. So, don't be shy. We're open.
Are you open for? I know you were open earlier for breakfast, but then it started open up later. What are your hours?
Yeah. So the during.
Yeah, we're helping you right now.
Yeah. 7 a.m. Monday through Friday. 8 a.m. on weekends. Nice. We do still serve breakfast, and it's a great product. I love it. Yes, we don't have a drive-through, but It's still in and out if you're on your way to work. It's quick, it's delicious. That might be a biased opinion, but I really do like it myself.
Now, do you have call ahead?
We do. Yes, sir. We have...
You got that number now.
Yeah. Yeah, I
actually, we're helping you.
Yes, thank you. I actually...
you had a hat he put it on, too.
You're going to get a free sub when this...
No.
It doesn't work that way.
No.
Now, you can...
Hey. Make sure that's deleted here, Mr. Officer. You got the 7-second delay button?
What? That's too funny.
Oh my God, Scott. All right, go ahead. Yeah. Make sure we work on a 7-second delay button, okay?
I'll hold my breath for that.
Yeah, so the great thing about Subway right now is we are doing a lot with technology. We have remote ordering, so you can go on. Yeah, you can go on the Subway website. You can, it's kind of taking call ahead ordering one step further. So now you can go on online. You can place your order. You can even download the Subway app on your phone.
Wait for the app. Yep.
Yeah. You can place your order on that. You can pay for it ahead of time. So when you walk in that door, you can skip the line, go right to the cash register. It's already paid for, and we can just hand you your sub, and you can be on your way. So. That's something that Subway is providing. You can go on Google Sunderland Subway. The hours and the phone numbers right there. Everything you could possibly need. So
excellent. All right. Anything else you want to add?
I think you helped
I
out.
Think we covered it pretty well. Didn't we? All right.
Thank you very much.
So we have a motion for a common vic and a food permit. Motion made and seconded. All those in favor of getting this young man on his way, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Cherry 30, please.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank
Good
you
luck.
All.
I hope you do well.
Appreciate it.
He's on his way.
Okay. Next up, we have CHA. CHA.
He's got graphics, I see.
I brought the board in case we need
Why not? Want me to throw them up on this?
Can you get that okay, Lou?
Yeah, we'll get it on.
Yeah, I put the drainage pitch in.
It's pretty flat.
Minor right. Puddling ahead.
Good evening.
John, where are we going now tonight?
Well, tonight, I'm in here to talk about the North Main Street project. We were last in back in January with the planning board to talk about some of the options for the improvements of North Main Street between Route 116 and
Claybrook
Road. Yes, and there were some questions as to whether we should be looking at an off-road bicycle path instead of trying to accommodate the bicycles in a shoulder along the road. And following that meeting, I had sent a request to the town to for some direction, basically, as to which way we should proceed with our design. And it's kind of been on a holding pattern for the last few months. So Sherry had forwarded me some questions from the Community Pathways Committee, and I figured we would go through those tonight, if you'd like.
All right, where do you want to start?
Okay, do you want to go through each of the...
If you want,
sure. Comments right
five now. Points. There's 5 points in the original. One of them was design exception. And...
Well, the Community Pathway Committee had 11 different things.
We'll go there.
You want to go through that list?
Yeah.
Okay, so the first one was, does CHA agree that separated bike lanes are preferred within at least part of the corridor? Our our preference would be to keep the bicycles within the shoulder of the roadway. We think that has the least impacts as far as potential tree roots, and would meet the MassDOT criteria. There are some other options that would still work, but they may have more impacts to the trees along the corridor, and we can discuss those as we go through the other question. But I think, in our opinion, the one that would work the best would be to keep it, the bicycles in the shoulders. So we'd basically be widening the road from the existing 26 feet wide to a width of 32 feet wide. We'd have 11-foot lanes and 5-foot shoulders, which would accommodate the bicycles. And we would reconstruct the two sidewalks that exist today. They would be very close to the existing location of the sidewalks, with some bump outs to try to avoid impacts to tree roots that would require easements from private property in order to avoid those trees.
So what's your personal opinion when you go into a road that's wider, now it's 26, you're going to widen it to 32, what will that do to the traffic speed-wise? Does it give people a feeling of more openness where they may go at a higher rate of speed?
There's the potential for that in some roadways. More on roadways that maybe have obstructions on the side of the road, that if you're widening the road and say there's a slope on the side of the road or ledge or something like that, if you're blasting the ledge and making the whole thing feel wider, there may be a potential to increase speeds. On this roadway in particular, it's already pretty wide open. I mean, your width of pavement might be getting wider, but it already feels pretty open because the trees are set so far back from the roadway. The road is very straight already. We're not changing the alignment of the road. We're not straightening the road. It's already straight. So, in my opinion, I don't think you're going to see much of a difference in travel speeds. If people want to go fast, they can go fast now. They don't. Having a little bit more room for the bicycles, I don't see that making people go faster.
Okay, Scott, comments, thoughts?
Not quite yet. With respect to bicycles, I mean, I have an opinion, but I think it's important to go through CHA's responses and then circle back to their impacts on design exception. So,
okay. Jamie?
Yeah, I would agree.
All right.
Okay, so the second question was, should we keep the existing sidewalks on both sides of the roads at the limits of right-of-way? If we were to decide to remove one or both, we'd need to extend existing walkways from houses to the new pathway. Historical folks' input on this would be needed if feasible options include removal of one or both of the existing walks from their current location. So basically, MassDOT requires sidewalks or pedestrian accommodations on both sides of your roadway in order to have a complete street. So we cannot just eliminate a sidewalk from one side of the road without going to them and requesting a design exception. Now, the pedestrians could be accommodated in a shared-use path, which is some of the other questions on here as well, in lieu of a sidewalk. But you do need to have pedestrian accommodations on both sides of the roadway. And if you did take out one of the sidewalks and ask for a design exception, then I guess the question would be, what would you do with people's walkways? Would you extend them all the way to the road? Probably. I'm not sure you'd want to extend their walkways all the way to the road if you get rid of the sidewalks. You'd be dumping the people out into the roadway at that point.
Okay.
The next question was, would separate single directional bike lanes fit within the corridor on both sides of the road to North Silver Lane? And are unique crossings of driveways for bikes and pedestrians more dangerous?
Question.
So, there is enough right-of-way to fit single-directional bike lanes on both sides of the corridor. The drawback to putting in a single-directional bike lane on both sides, in addition to the travelway and the sidewalks, is now you have five different strips of pavement out there. Right now, you've got three strips of pavement. You got the road, you got two sidewalks. Now you're going to add...
I would think the other thing is, I don't care. Some people, some bicyclists would use the separate bike lane, and you get just as many using the
right.
road, in my opinion.
Yeah.
I just seen that happen before.
Right. So, yeah, the bicyclists may not even use it. I mean, some of the hardcore bicyclists might stay in the road, so...
The hardcore bicycles will stay in the road. If there's a pack of 30 of them, they aren't going on. They're not going to pull off the road.
So I don't think that is a really a good idea for that option. And the second part of that question was whether would crossings with the driveway be dangerous? So if you put in the bike lanes, they would have to cross all of the driveways. I don't see that as a big deal, but like we said, I don't think the whole idea of having these separate bike lanes, bicycle-only lanes, is a good idea. So the fourth question was, would a single wide shared-use path on one side of the roadway with removal of sidewalks be a viable alternative, physically or politically?
Depends on whose side of the street. Let's just be honest.
Yeah. So, like I said previously, you need pedestrian accommodations on both sides of the roadway. So eliminating both of the sidewalks and putting in one shared use path on one side of the roadway would not meet MassDOT's complete street criteria.
And I'm guessing that's the what started question two was the thought probably that, you know, if we get rid of a sidewalk, can we, because otherwise there really wouldn't be a reason to get rid of a sidewalk.
No, you'd keep one and maybe put the shared use on one side.
That's where I think the question two came from. Yes. Just for clarification, it wasn't like a...
All right, so the next question was, can a shared use path have one-way bicycle with both direction walking? It may be feasible to create a path that has, you'd have to put in some pavement markings that basically delineated half of the path for a bicycle, and you'd have to sign it and stripe it so that people understood that was a bicycle lane for one direction only, and the other half of the path be for pedestrians, and they could walk both directions. But that, once again, does not meet the criteria to have sidewalk on both sides of the road. So you still need a sidewalk on the other side of the road, and then you'd still need to accommodate the bicycles traveling in the other direction, either in the roadway or on another shared use path on the other side. So you basically end up with shared use paths on both sides of the road, with bicycles in one direction only on each side of the road, but the pedestrians could walk both directions. So, I mean, it may be possible, but...
I guess as the question may be more focused, is there room to do that on both sides? Because I thought I saw in one of the plans that was one of the options, essentially, at some point, if I recall.
We had drawn up a concept that would show a shared use path on one side of the road, or just a bicycle path on one side of the road, either one, and keeping the sidewalks separate. I think our concept that we've shown previously, I think, was to put a two-way bicycle path on one side of the road, keep the sidewalks separate, and then have narrow shoulders in the roadway. So that's an option. The other option, which we haven't got to yet, would be basically put a shared use path on one side of the road, eliminate the sidewalk on that side of the road, let the shared use path be a lot usable by bicycles in both directions and pedestrians. Mm-hmm. So it's shared by everybody on that side of the road, but keep a sidewalk on the other side. I think that's probably the most feasible option of all these off-road bicycle accommodation options. It just will require a minimum of 10-foot wide section of pavement for a shared use path like that.
Right, to accommodate both.
To accommodate both. And has the potential to impact tree roots on whichever side you put the path on, which side of the road you put the path on.
So does that help with keeping the road at its narrowest acceptable footprint, the actual car travel way?
Yeah, there is the possibility of keeping the road about the same width it is today of 26 feet.
Does that include design exception? I didn't mean to interrupt.
It may not actually require a design exception.
Okay.
We received a word from Mass DOT. I reached out to them back in February or March, so that was since I've been here last, to find out if the project could qualify as what's called a 3R project, mm-hmm. which is, I think it's resurfacing, rehabilitation, and restoration. May not have those R's correct, but basically the status allows for, if you're not really changing a lot to the roadway and it's just more of a rehab project, it allows you not to be subject to the 13 design criteria that the Federal Highway requires for projects. It still means you have to accommodate, they have two other criteria which you still need to meet, which is the bicycle embedded accommodation.
Sure, that makes sense.
So if we can get them to continue to agree, I've seen them change their mind on projects, that this is a 3R project, then we would not have to go and request formal design exceptions, provided we have the pedestrian and bicycle accommodations off the road. So that is something that's new since the last time we came in.
Okay. That's good to know. But
there is, I will caveat that with, we were originally told on another project that we would qualify for 3R, and then they changed their mind after we submitted 25% design.
Sure. I hear you totally. And that would actually
risk category.
Yes.
That would actually get in.
Yeah,
right. Yeah. Reject.
But to me, the only problem is you're still, now you've changed the whole process of our snow removal, and now you're removing on the, you know, you've got your regular road, plus now you're going to have removal on that 10-foot.
Right, the wider
portion,
side.
Right. And you're going to have a sidewalk. So now you got now you're making and what priority do you put on you know, on that
wide side?
And again, I just think it's
right. You will have to maintain the you know, plow that, keep it accessible during the winter for bicycles.
Four bicycles.
Yeah, it would have to be. You'd have to maintain the full width of that path so that it's not just for pedestrians.
Right. And I could be wrong, but my driving different places, I have not seen bicycles use dedicated places like that. They would use the main, typically a lot of them, not everyone, because some people aren't comfortable riding on the road, but
right.
Your people that are out biking a lot, which we see many around here do, they would, I don't think they would pull off and use that.
Right. I mean, I think it's more common.
Not long distance, at least. I mean, if you had something long distance, fine, but if you're talking half a mile?
Right. It works better if you have like a rail trail or something that's off the road. It's a long, continuous thing that you know, people actually come to ride their bikes on this structure. But if you're just doing this for a short section, relatively short, half a mile, a lot of the bicyclists aren't going to get over because in one direction you're gonna have to cross the road to get to it, and then you're gonna have to cross back when you get to the end of it, to the other side of the road, to continue on if you were heading it up, you know, to
to yeah, down by the, if you come down to the intersection, you're going to need to cross back across the highway to get
right
to your correct all directional right. lane. Yeah.
All right. Next.
Okay. So there were other questions. Would multi-use pathways, one on each side, fit geometrically? They will fit. The big question is how many tree roots are we going to impact? And they will fit within the right of way. The right of way is quite wide here, so they'll fit. They won't necessarily be in the tree line, but the question is, will they impact the roots? And they will also alter your drainage, because right now the roadway drainage, the water sheet just flows off the side of the road into what is kind of a swale, and then at the bottom of that swale is basically where your bike shed use paths are going to be. So you're going to have to introduce drainage structures along the bike path, and that's going to add cost to your project.
And drainage for both sections as well, not just the road surface, but also the
drainage for the bike path.
Bike path as well.
Right. And you got the same issues that you had in question number 5.
Right.
The same plowing issues. It
right.
seems like the shared route thing achieves, because we've got a couple, it may not necessarily be the best for bikers and that they may not use it, but the benefit, there is a benefit to that in terms of traffic calming, and that's one of our big concerns mm-hmm. is that as it is, people are going really fast down there. So we definitely need to somehow focus on some kind of traffic calming.
Right. And, you know, we can try to do that with some signage and things like that.
I don't want to skip ahead, sorry.
But, traffic calming, it's going to be a challenge on this job. It's a very straight, wide open road.
Yep.
And there's not much there to slow people down. You know, we can do it with signs. We talked about one of our last hearing. We've going to look at a crosswalk and potentially putting in some, you know, flashing warning signs for people using the crosswalk, you know, really sign the crosswalk very well and make it feel like you know you're coming into an area that you need to slow down into. So those are some of the things that we can try to do on the roadway to try to slow people down.
So John, just as you talk about crosswalks, in some, would it be advantageous to maybe add a couple crosswalks along the length of North Main Street, as a potential calming effect, and maybe so people could cross at different locations? Right now, people. When I walk it, we just go on a driveway and walk across. Maybe we should add a couple crosswalks, you know, because you get half a mile, maybe go up a quarter, well, not a quarter mile, but a distance, pick whatever the thing, maybe throw a couple sidewalks, and maybe you could put, you know, just a crosswalk, use an imprint part, you know, maybe an imprinted
pavement.
Right, the resin bricks. Imprint that looks like it's a brick.
Or maybe a high vis walkway, yeah. You know, when you got maybe something like that. Maybe that would help as a calming of device also.
I mean, I think those things can help, and we were looking at potentially a crosswalk down at the end of the project, since that's where our sidewalks are going to end, down by Claybrook, and then maybe another one near North Silver. And then
one over here by the Blue Heron.
Potentially down by the Blue Heron.
Right. Yeah.
Down towards the beginning of the project.
Yeah, I think if you max out the use of that, it's going to have, I think you're right, it'll have the dual benefit of giving people easier access across the road. Mm-hmm. And it is a little bit of a mental signal to somebody to say, oh, okay, there's another crosswalk coming up.
Yep.
And if you paint them, you know, if you paint them and they're well marked, People will recognize those locations.
Right. Raise them about 2.5 inches too.
Yeah, like the over at there you go.
Like Amherst College.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, I mean, we're looking to try to do things with signage and markings to make you feel like you're coming into a different area, an area where there's a lot of activity, a lot of pedestrians, an area where you need to slow down. You know, you're not in the forested or farmland, or you're in a residential area where there's going to be potentially somebody crossing the road.
Yeah, maybe look at something like that. Okay.
Okay, so I think there's a question about why is the currently proposed sidewalk 5.5 feet wide. I'm not sure where the 5.5 feet came from, because our plans do indicate that they would be 5 foot wide. That's the MassDOT minimum. ADA does allow you to go down to 4 feet wide, but then you have to provide every couple hundred feet, you have to provide what's called a passing zone for wheelchairs to pass each other. And MassDOT really pushes for the 5 foot minimum sidewalks. It'll be difficult to get them to agree to something less than 5 feet wide.
Skipped over number 8 there. Number 7 we've kind of covered in different ways. But.
Oh, yes. Number 8. Have we identified all the utilities on the base map? They don't show up on the concept plan, but our design plans do have all the underground utilities shown. The concept plans, I think, only show the structures on top of the catch basins, but they don't show where the pipes go and the underground utilities. But we do have a survey has located all the underground utilities. For any records that are available, there could be things that are unknown under the ground. It's not uncommon, but to find a utility that nobody had a record of, everything we could find has been included on the plans. So number 10, has CHA thought about islands within the roadway at crossings to calm traffic? The only reason we wouldn't propose islands is we still need to maintain bicycle accommodations. So if you put in a median island or at a crosswalk, you still have to have your 11-foot lane and your 5-foot shoulder to get around the island.
Well, so you kind of have to then.
So you'd have to bump out the roadway to go around the island to keep the bicycle accommodation past the island. Mm-hmm. Now, if you did an off-road path, then maybe you could do something there, but it's not very practical if we're trying to meet the bicycle accommodations that MassDOT requires us to do. Okay.
If I could, Mr. Chair.
What's that?
Dan, does that cover a lot of the?
Yeah, no, it's good. It's good. It's good to get the feedback and get your thoughts.
Okay. And the last one was whether we could separate bike access to French's Ferry Road. Possible. I think we've covered that. French's Ferry Road.
Because we end here at Claybrook.
I think French's Ferry Road is one of the. It shows up just as a driveway.
Before Claybrook. Yeah.
It's before Claybrook. So it runs into the same issues as the. We've discussed previously about potentially impacting trees along the corridor.
We've got a sidewalk on that side up to Claybrook, so access is at that point there enhanced compared to what it is currently.
Yes, we are planning to have the sidewalks continue all the way to Claybrook on both sides of the road.
I remember there was discussion at one point in the design about a crossover and then extension on one side or the other.
I think the consensus we heard was that we should keep the sidewalks on both sides, even if it does involve either a sidewalk easement from some of the residences or it could be a taking, either one. It could be an easement or a taking.
Okay.
I think that was the
question.
Yeah, this is a different question. Setting aside the whole biking thing, what problem is the town trying to solve by reconstructing North Main Street?
My understanding was that the roadway pavement is deteriorating, so it's requires rehabilitation, as well as some of the drainage. We'll be replacing structures and pipes along the corridor, and also to improve bicycle and pedestrian accommodations. The sidewalks are in poor condition, and it currently does not accommodate bicycles. Or doesn't.
Can one of these grants cover just underground improvements?
Like your mechanicals.
Like the drainage and whatever else.
Just do the drainage?
I'm just wondering. I mean, you get a lot of hoops to jump through here to try to satisfy a lot of things. And if all you were doing was the underground and the Chapter 90 paid the damn thing, you're done. Can I see the end?
Typically the DOT, the project has to be a complete project. So you're reconstructing the whole roadway. It's not just a drainage project under this program.
Well, probably with complete streets, they want us to look at it more holistically now, too.
Exactly. They want a complete street usable by all roadway users. That's part of their healthy transportation policy.
That's a good question, though, because you get this far in and you wonder, well, what kind of started it all?
Right.
What was the impetus in the very beginning? Because sometimes you...
Is the drainage, I mean, based on your look at the drainage, is it pretty much you're going to have to replace most of the pipe?
Yes. I mean, we haven't, done a TV survey or anything like that, but my understanding is that from discussions with the highway department is that all the pipe will need to be replaced.
Both sides of the town.
All the drainage.
Rock?
Just one more question. These improvements, are they mostly benefiting Sunderland residents or non-Sunderland residents?
I think it benefits all roadway users. I would say primarily the Sunderland residents will be the ones doing the walking and probably the bicycling. There may be people doing long distance bicycling that also use the road. And the Sunderland residents probably drive the road more than anyone else as well.
Well, we do know that the underground is sorely in need of upgrade, especially on the drainage. We had also talked about putting along the place conduit under the ground just in case in the future we have to add something. I think we as a board are going to need to address. Long-term, we if you live on North and South Main Street, when it comes to the sewer, it's pretty amazing, in my opinion, because theoretically, if you live on one side of the road and the sewer's on the other side of the road, you're responsible from your home to
the tie.
To the sewer.
You own under the road.
Yeah.
I don't quite understand how that... I don't know if you just hire your local excavator to come in and chop up the road and
state road, yeah. In theory.
So I think we have to address it and to the point where, you know, we may want to, and I'm not saying I would do it tomorrow,
right?
But I would think that we would say, you know, from the home up to the right of way, you're responsible. But after the right of way, the town would pick up the sewer. To me, that makes
the
sense.
The sewer users would pick it up.
The sewer users right. Pick it up, yeah, absolutely.
It's important to bear in mind, someone on Plumtree is not going to pay for that. It's going to be the sewer users.
Yeah, absolutely, Scott. You're right. And we haven't done a lot. We haven't done a lot of infrastructure repair. We know the road is in need of serious work. You're probably right when you talk about bike riders in the center of town. It's probably not as much a concern as when you get up further on 47 up and down, because the traffic speeds are a little bit slower, except if you have two cars that are coming in opposite direction and there's bikes on the road. When I learned how to drive, if there was a bicycle in your line, in your lane, you slowed down, let the other car pass, and then after that car safely passed, then you pulled out and went around the bike. I think sometime between I learned how to drive with my driving instructor. Thank you, Mr. Fifield. Something happened, and today everybody thinks they got the right of way. And when you come up to a bicyclist or a group of bicyclists, doesn't matter what side of the road, no one slows down, and now everybody's meeting in the center of the road. So I don't know how we lost that common courtesy, but we have.
Yeah, the rules haven't changed.
It's frankly one of many common courtesies we've lost.
Like they have a term, it says right of way. I always was taught that meant the person to the right has, but whatever.
Well, I'm thinking about like your question though. I would hope too down the road that it also benefits potential business in Sunderland by making Main Street a little more pedestrian friendly and walkable and everything. Yeah, I'm hoping that could be a side benefit, you know, that it makes it more conducive for businesses too. Because that all, to me, I think is wrapped up in benefits to the community.
Yeah, I agree with you, David.
You know, absolutely. We get a lot of people. There will be a lot of people who aren't from Sunderland who, but that they bike through here.
Sure.
So,
you know, it was interesting. We had a visitor before our meeting, and he was talking about the sidewalks down on his street.
Mm-hmm.
And basically the highway superintendent 10 years ago, whatever it was, connected from just to the south of the Go 10, mm-hmm. came down the rest of the old Amherst Road to mm-hmm. connect to the state sidewalk along 116. And it's amazing the amount of foot traffic now on the path. And this gentleman was mentioning he's a huge part of his life in town. And he would say, like, very rarely would you see anybody walking. And now you're seeing families walking the streets. So I would hope if we had two pathways going up and we make it, I would think if we extended eventually along North Silver Lane, we would probably provide that same type of walkability to the town. And
kind of that build it and they will use it kind of thing.
It's amazing, but it's been done and we've seen what's happened. So, Scott.
Two questions if I could, John. The first is, in the scope of work that you guys have got laid out and hopefully qualifying for the TIP, we know there's stormwater, we know there is wastewater, we know there is water. The water is done by the Sunderland Water District. Is that included in this project? Any work by the Water District, say they want to go in and deal with upgrading their lines?
If they wanted to upgrade their lines, it would have to be a cost borne by them.
So it could be a timing thing, but they may want to be able to go in and consider that themselves.
Right. Okay. So they would either want to do it ahead of time themselves, or if they wanted to be part of this project, they would have to pay MassDOT's contractor that's selected for those items of work.
Got it.
Which may cost them more in the long run because they don't have any control over the bid price of that item.
Yep. Just wanted to ask. And then lastly would be electric cable and telephone. We know there's poles of particular vintages. How integrated are the local utilities, in this case here, Eversource and then Comcast and...
Once we make a 25% design, the plans will go out to all of the utility companies, mm-hmm. and they will review them to see what impacts the project has on their
30-foot, 100-year-old cedar poles.
And then there will actually be a MassDOT will coordinate a site meeting with all the utility companies to come out, and they'll go through everything. And
that's upon approval of the application as a TIP, or as part of the design phase?
That's part of the design process.
There's no surprises at the end. You go, oh, geez, and by the way, we want to do all this other stuff while we're here.
Right.
Good.
And MassDOT, if the project requires something to be moved, like a utility pole, the DOT will reimburse the utility company for 50% of that cost, and the utility company pays the other 50% of that cost.
Yeah. Okay. Just a question, just for clarification, because I imagine somebody might ask about it. To say this way, has anybody considered putting electric underground? Just to clarify for people, you know what I mean? Because I could picture somebody asking that too at this point, you know?
Right. Mass DOT won't pay for that cost. It is very expensive to relocate utility lines underground, and that's not a cost that the DOT we typically will pay for.
So we can take a hat out and put our sunglasses on and curbside for that one.
Although, but just kind of what made me think of it too was that the following day after I got elected, I was out because all the lines on South Main were down.
Yeah.
And, you know, you wonder how many times do you do that before it becomes...
Sure.
I understand putting them underground doesn't solve every problem, and sometimes it causes other issues. But I think it's in our... part of our responsibility to ask the questions, you know, and also just to clarify for people, because they wonder, well, you're digging it up. I put them underground at that time.
Yeah. So it is something that, you know, I think could be included as part of the project, but the town would have to bear the cost. Yeah.
It's also important to bear in mind that all of the interconnections on all of the dwellings would have to be reworked.
Yeah, right.
It's going to be
gets expensive.
Yeah, right. It's not like just running the main wire down because they all connect from the pole up to the outside of your house. So.
Right. Point. Thank you, Mr. Chair. If we could circle back around to the first page where we had five questions from CHA themselves asking us for guidance. I thank Dan for his extra effort on this, as well as a Pathways Committee for these reviews. I think the questions about sidewalk width, bike path, they were exploration questions on a similar theme. I think that's really good to have. What about left? What about right? What about combined? What about separate? I think that was really helpful. We have five that your office sent to us, and that was centered around additional engineering. I think it actually ties to some of the exploration that Pathways has gone on.
Right.
And if we could revisit those 1 through 5, that would be helpful. And Dan, I think this would allow us some further exploration outside of just opinion or feeling.
Right. Okay, yeah, one of the things that was discussed at the last hearing was what to do with the parking down by the Blue Herring.
It's down here.
Yep. And, you know, we had a concept to keep it very similar to what it is today with perpendicular parking. We had presented some options. Put in potentially some angle parking, perhaps put in an island separating the parking from the road a bit more, which would require it to be angle parking. All the options that we showed for changing it would reduce the number of spaces. So we were kind of looking for guidance whether the town wanted to do anything, change anything down there. As far as the parking goes, is it more important to maintain the number of spaces or to try to, change the feel of that area?
I don't know if... I mean, at the risk, you're losing spaces, and I don't know how much of a benefit we're getting because of the size of the area. It'd be one thing if it was wider, and I think we had more space to put, like, a little median strip to divide it. I think reducing the spaces is going to kind of go counterproductive to certainly the commercial aspect and the usability, because we've also got the spaces on the other side for the...
Right.
That's the park and ride spots, too.
Right.
And it acts as overflow too for town events and things like that.
Yeah, and we're looking at this in a 3-season format. What happens with the snow? What do you do with an island space?
Yeah, exactly.
What does it do?
Looking into it with our plows and things.
With respect to the parking, I think if we have enough challenges with parking in that particular area, with a concentration of businesses as well as a fair amount of day use parking. Kind of interesting. A lot of people park there. There are other businesses that are not the restaurants that operate. There is certainly there. ServiceNet is there now, and a fair amount of day parking. So I think reducing parking would be a challenge. I do like the idea of the exploration about another kind of highlighted, illuminated, high vis, some kind of crosswalk there, because that's a long stretch to kind of cut across, and we don't exactly have. Sprinters parking and walking across.
All right. Well, we'll look to see how to best incorporate a crosswalk in that area.
Just reminded me of a question I had earlier, too, is in thinking in the bigger picture, you know, you've got multiple crosswalks. Mm-hmm. It seems like this would be a good opportunity to use some for the complete streets grants to help out with some of the equipment and things like that in those crosswalks. That'll be a perfect example of what to use complete streets funding for, and maybe not tap into some of the other funding mechanisms for this.
If there's anything that the state wouldn't pay for under this program, then yes, the complete streets funding, I assume the town's going through that process to get approved.
Yeah, or like the flashing things. Yeah, okay.
So with respect to item one, I don't see any reason to pursue that unless there's reason. Okay, so one sounds like there's a no. Okay, John?
Okay.
And then two, proceed with sidewalks on both sides all the way to the projected playbook. I think it seems that there's some consensus built around that. And if we're going to explore that and incorporate that, that would make some sense.
I would agree, yeah.
Okay, so that sounds like it's a yes, John.
Okay.
Item three, design exception. You know, with the questions that we just went around earlier about design exceptions and the exploration of the 3R project versus design exceptions, I don't know how much more time or additional cost that would be. Does it qualify? Does it not qualify? If we stay in a similar configuration to what's here and keep the roads as narrow as we possibly can, is a design exception request required, in your opinion?
Based on the concept we have now, mm-hmm. no design exception is required. That's with a 5-foot shoulder mm-hmm. for the bicycles on both sides of the road and 11-foot travel lanes. Mm-hmm. Those both meet the Mass DOT minimums. We're at the minimum. Anything below that requires a design exception.
Okay.
And we have sidewalks proposed on both sides throughout the project limits, so that does not require a design exception either. So if we go with this concept, then no design exception is required. Some of the bicycle alternatives that we discussed may require a off-road bicycle accommodations mm-hmm. For bicycles may require a design exception depending on which one was chosen. So at this point, if we go forward with this concept, then no design exception would be required.
Not entirely sure we've fully vetted some of those options yet, though. I mean, we want to have the design exception time set aside. You know, we have an appropriation from annual town meeting. So it's not that we want you guys to spin your wheels while we go about this public discussion.
Right.
I think there's enough consensus amongst the community that making it, you know, 6+ feet wider in one big lane of blacktop, there's some consternation about. So I think I would like to continue to explore without necessarily applying for the design exception. Is that possible yet?
Yes. I mean, until we decide which concept we're going with, we wouldn't need the funding for the design exception report until we've decided that we actually want to go for that design.
Uh-huh. So what would be your reduction, though, Scott?
What would be the...
Your minimum...
You got 11-foot travel lane.
Yeah. So
that's where we're at now.
That's what we have right now.
Right.
So what are your options? Do you want to put the bike lane someplace else?
Well, I think that's part of the discussion we had earlier in the night. Do you make it wide? How do you get input and out? How do you get enter and exit?
Right. How many bikes would even do that?
Good point.
Right. So the way it is now, it's more a matter of visual delineation of the bike lane from the auto travel lane, right?
Right. I mean,
in other words, let's say we're keeping this. Yep. So what do you mechanically do?
So basically, your bike lane is you'll have a white line on your edge, edge of your travel lane,
painting
outside of that. And you have the option to either stripe it as a bike lane, which you'd put some bicycle markings in the lane. So basically a little picture, painted bicycle in the lane. Yeah. Or you can just keep it as a shoulder without that's usable by bicycles. It's not required to make it into a, quote, bike lane. It can just be a 5 foot wide shoulder, which is wide enough to accommodate bicycles. I so you have your option of those two.
I think in, it's South Street in Northampton has a rumble strip separating the bike lane and paint.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So you get your regular 11-foot road, you get your lines for the cars back and forth, and then there's rumble strip, then there's the bike lane.
Yeah, that's something we could discuss with the DOT as well.
Again, it's something that's on that particular street. It helps physically, it helps remind you.
It's an audible.
Yeah, exactly.
In addition to
it. It just helps remind you.
Right.
Well, and again, I don't have a question, but the only reason I would caution is that one of the reasons at the university, they... you ever been down Mass Ave? I think it's Mass Ave.
Mm-hmm.
Out in front of Whitmore, you'll notice that they have rumble strips,
mm-hmm.
right? One side has three sets of rumble strips. The other side has one rut set because they figured out that the rumble strips cause a lot of noise.
Sure, sure.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, I agree. There's audible noise.
And I would say if you're living on North Main Street, you have a truck come down the road at 2 in the morning and he's running down the rumble strips, you may not want to hear that.
Correct.
That's a good point. That is always a concern with rumble strips, yes.
Yeah. Just because of the noise.
Yeah.
Although it's good to discuss it and then get that issue out there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that we know that. So when we've talked about it, we talk about the positive and negative of it.
Yeah, I would just say I
good point.
I don't have, I don't care. I mean, I don't live on North Main Street.
That was observation.
I think people would be.
Sure.
It might be an issue, yep. You have to pause your conversation while somebody rips along the rumble strip.
Can't go wrong.
Yeah. But I think if you're just looking at painting, I think it's a minimal thing to mark off the bike thing. And I think it behooves us for a lot of reasons to not just leave it as... shoulder as it is now.
Yeah, I think,
you know, it's a minimal.
I think the bicycle lanes, you know, painting it, making it really look like a bicycle lane could actually help calm the traffic a bit.
Yeah. And you don't have to go with the full thing of like painting the whole bike lane green or something. You know, there's, like you're discussing,
right?
Like I've seen the little bike graphics and maybe an occasional little V or something
right.
like that. Yeah. There's ways to do it without.
Okay. So item four, right? Additional exploration of feasibility of bicycle accommodations.
Right. So, I mean, that's basically, do you want us to look more closely at any of the off-road path options? We did a very quick look to see which side of the road, you know, might be able to accommodate it. And it was, you know, a very preliminary look. And the question is, do we want to spend more time looking at it in more detail to see if, you know, we can figure out exactly the best location for it and try to pinpoint the number of trees that would be impacted and, you know, figure out what the drainage issues are. I mean, we could spend a lot of time looking at, you know,
what are your thoughts, Steve?
Different alternatives.
It would be great to see just a single multi-use lane, just looked at and see where it could fit, where you think it could fit. You just point out what the problems are with it.
Right.
I mean, whether, you know, and I think it would mean, I think what we're talking is one sidewalk would come out on one side of the road, you'd have a multi-use lane straight through that would fit. And that's why I was getting into the islands, because if you did something like that, you could have big wide island crossings, it'd open up flexibility to do more things. But again, if you just take a quick look and see where you think it could fit, I'd recommend doing it just to see. And then if people don't want to do it and they see something on paper that shows exactly where it is, they can think about it and see what comes up with a decision.
There is a good point, and that actually feeds well into the fifth and final item, which is more outreach. You know, we can have some of these extended contractual relationship with CHA to explore these, but it really does turn into outreach again. And that's really important when all is said and done. Because, Dan, we might have a room full of people who look at it and say, right, thanks for looking at it, but, yeah, exactly.
We do our due diligence.
My personal experience is that when you sit around the water cooler and talk about things, they sound very good.
Yeah.
Yeah, until you see it.
And then you put them on paper, mm-hmm. and just like the rumble strip, great idea. And don't get me wrong.
It works on South Street. Right. It may not work here.
Right. Yeah. And don't get me wrong. The only thing I would think is, and I go back to the reason why the state wouldn't do it on 116. Right. Remember?
Yep.
Because of the noise. Right. When we were talking about trying to do something there, and the state says, you're not going to want to do that.
Not with the traffic volume and proximity.
And they said you may want not do that because of the noise. Mm-hmm. And then it was shortly thereafter at university where how come there's no one on this side and three on the other side? Well, they started putting them in, and all of a sudden they saw how much noise they were causing, and there's a lot of noise.
Sure.
Well, it's like you solve one problem, but you create another one.
Right. So I would agree with Dan if you could just put it on. I think if you put it on paper, mm-hmm. it may sound great. But if you put it on paper and all of a sudden somebody says, wait a second, how are we going to get from this side to that side?
Right.
And will bicycles actually use, I mean.
Well, that's why I wish we had Gary here just from his past experience. Like, would you, when you come to an area like that, would you use it?
Go off the road, onto the walk, back onto the road. I just spend around the vineyard knows that.
That's where you're coming and think, you know.
Yeah.
And I've talked to bikes, so the guys who do it hardcore, they're more interested. They don't want
to go on a straight line.
Driveways. They just want to blast through town.
Right.
There's certainly that, but I'm thinking it's multi-use all ages.
Yep. Well, right, like young kids learning how to ride a bike. And
it kind of ties into the pathways.
Mm-hmm. Smart.
Just the hardcore bike lanes.
Good points.
Well, but the problem is that if you do something like that, then you still have the problem. You're not really, if the bikes aren't using that pull off, then you're recreating the problem that you have where, you know, people are.
It's more traffic calming. You get the
I don't know if we've done enough traffic calming that. Well, and you're right. It's airline. Straight. And it's mm-hmm. it's straight and it's open now. And me, I'd probably be putting vertical posts down the between
down the middle
between the road and the bicycle just to make it look smaller. But you know what would happen?
Sure.
The first time,
the
farm tractor with the seven bottom pile goes up through. Mm-hmm. Guess what happens to all the posts?
Pitching, pitching, pitching as they knock them out. Although I like the idea of the raised roads. You get some air coming down Main Street.
Becomes sport. So, with respect, Mr. Chair, to 4 and 5. It seems that those make sense. We still want to see something visually to bring forward, and likely we would also want to have public hearings around there.
Yeah.
That's fine.
One other piece, if I could, John, is to bear in mind that, right, I don't know if it's here or not, it's not there quite yet, town of Sunderland,
right.
there is where this current drive is.
Okay.
There is the possibility of as many as 22 senior housing units back here. So this cut may not affect this today, mm-hmm. but those meetings are ongoing, and that project looks like it will likely manifest itself.
Okay.
So that's on 120 is the street address. Okay.
Yep.
That was 22 new units?
22 units, yeah. Out behind. It's still going to be single access, but it may be different than.
Okay, yeah, I'll follow up and just keep me abreast if that continues to go forward, and we'll make sure we incorporate it in the plan.
Yeah. So 4 and 5 look good, John. We have to work on it. Okay.
Yep. Plan to move forward with those then?
Yep.
Okay.
If you can come up with any creative traffic calming, because I think that's really one concern that everybody has across the board. I mean, I know there's fairly strict rules and things, but, you know, I would just strongly suggest thinking as creatively as possible about traffic calming.
Okay, so I mean, going forward, we will take a closer look at the bicycle off-road alternatives and some traffic calming, then plan to come back before the town with another outreach meeting.
Yeah.
It could either be select board or planning board or however you want to do it.
That's fine.
That'd be perfect.
We'll have a joint here between us all.
Okay.
Okay.
Great.
Thank you, John.
Thanks so much, Neil. Contract document.
Thank you for taking the time working through with us.
No problem. Thank
can you. We just keep them? No.
you can have them if you like.
You want to put them down the selectman's office.
Put them downstairs.
Yeah.
If you don't mind.
Or we can put them out in the hallway. People can look at.
Right. Great. Yeah. Where people look at.
Thanks so much. Just charge us for it. John, thanks for the time.
All right. Thank you. Have a good night.
All right. Minutes of May 23rd.
Motion on those.
I'll second.
We have a motion made and seconded on the minutes of May 23rd. That was a joint hearing with the town of Deerfield and Whiteley. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
3-0, please. The minutes of May 31st.
I'll make a motion for the minutes of the 31st.
Second.
May 31st was the minutes where we discussed the hiring of our person that's going to go forward in the police chief process, and we decided to forward Thomas Harding. All those in favor, we have a motion made and seconded. Please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Sherry, 3-0, please. Next up is Board of Selectmen updates. David, Scott?
I just have one quick update. It looks like there's actually been some action on the Comcast contract.
I thought that was all done.
I wish it was. Might have a meeting Saturday about it. So that's perfect. Been dragging on. I think it's been 10 years since we started. It feels like. I'm telling you. Oh. So.
Thank you, David. Mr. Bergeron?
Mr. Chair, we have our first meeting tomorrow with Chief Harding about contract negotiations. That'll be earlier in the afternoon. And then tomorrow night there is a working group for the 120 North Main Street meeting is going to be going over the first round of their RFPs, the presentation from the COG. So that's been going to be a very productive meeting. You know, we put that out there for design/construction services.
South County EMS had put out an RFP for housing of the facilities. There was two responses. In the committee, we have a building committee. They are going to take the responses and I believe open them up Wednesday night, so 6 o'clock, and discuss and grade them and see which to make a recommendation to the Deerfield Board of Selectmen.
Nice.
So we'll see where that goes. We had a South County Senior Center had a meeting this evening to, it was actually an interview with two finalists for the outreach coordinator's position. So we'll see what happens with that. Town Administrator?
I have a couple of things. The Community Pathways Committee is hoping to submit a park grant application on behalf of the town for improvements to town-owned land off School Street. Public hearing is being held on Wednesday at 7 to solicit community input. The committee also voted at their last meeting to hire Sarah Snyder to write the grant, pending board approval. $2,500 has been allocated from CPA funds for grant writing services. They wanted to pass that by the board to make sure that board is okay with that.
Sherry, you've done park grants in the past, right?
The last one that I did, it was actually under the self-help program, okay. Which is similar.
Okay.
And I did offer to assist the committee and Sarah, you know, as much as needed. The challenge with this grant application is the deadline is 6 weeks away.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a lot to pull together in 6 weeks.
Can you ask town council how that would look? I say that only because Sarah is not only wholly capable of executing the grant, I get that, but being a member of that working group, how does, you know?
Yeah, she did abstain from the vote.
Understood. If I could, Mr. Chair, I think it's got to pass the straight face test first.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, makes sense.
The other thing for the police department,
Thank you,
they had an employment application that has been revised as recommended by town council, and they'd like permission to post it to the website.
Okay.
So I did check that, and all the revisions have been made. We had a request for permission to park on town.
So the police application is different than the town application?
A little bit, yes.
Okay.
Different qualifications.
Did it go by the personnel committee? You guys are all set with it?
Yeah.
It did, and it also went by town council. Yeah.
We looked at it, and then we said it's approved pending. It's a council review. Just make sure we didn't miss anything.
Okay. So then it's okay to put it on the website? Okay.
We had a request from a resident, a Sunderland resident who works for DCR. She'd like to be able to park the state vehicle on town property. If that's okay.
Can we charge rent?
State employees, I guess, are not allowed to park their vehicles at their residences. So she just wanted me to check and make sure it was okay with the board, and if there was a certain...
Okay with
you. Do we have a parking meter in that spot yet?
If as long as it's not a electric car and wants to plug into a meter, it's fine.
Yeah.
I think the response of DCR has helped us with both with the mountain road work after Irene and high winds. They've been nothing but helpful. So
yeah, good point.
With regard to the solar project in Wamiko, DPU is accepting comment.
Please, we'd like to...
Please comment. Okay.
Please do.
Beth said she would be happy to prepare a response.
Can you please? Then. Yeah.
Okay. I noticed those highlighted notes by Beth on there, so...
Yeah.
As we used to say with Margaret, a salty letter.
Yes. Snappy.
But that, it's important to bear in mind as well, and Chair and I spoke earlier about this, that, you know, there is the opportunity for the town and the residents to comment during this rate review process. But it's also important to bear in mind we have a relationship with the utility that is complex. And if we're going to, you know, stick the stick in the beehive's nest, we've got to be ready for what happens in the future. I think that's from purely a principal perspective, the regulatory body should know what's gone on with our projects over the last 4 years, essentially. That's really important. And we should also at the same time reach out to the district manager and say, listen, in a lot of ways, this is one element of the work that you guys do for us. Then we're not unhappy with that work.
Right.
The only thing I will say is that I know exactly what you're saying.
Yeah.
I'm saying poor form on...
I agree.
If they do that, that's poor form.
Yep.
Because that is known in my world as a threat.
Yeah, retribution. Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly.
Okay, retribution.
Yep.
All right? And what I'm saying is that this is business.
Yep.
Plain and simple. Mm-hmm. They chose to perform. They chose to perform the way they did. We're not happy. Then to hold it against us because... Mm-hmm. That's ridiculous. That's like you see someone shot or commit a crime, and you're not going to report it because you're worried about what somebody to do to you. Hell no.
I agree. I understand. But again, we have a working relationship.
See, now you're getting me more fired up, and I think that
salty
should start with an F salty letter because they have a responsibility as a monopoly, as a public utility, to work for our benefit at all times. Not just their own, not just their ratepayers.
That's part of the giving them a monopoly. That's what
I agree.
Said.
So I I'm glad you said that, Scott, because a lot of people wouldn't say that.
Mm.
You know, it's the kind of thing that we just look at and kind of like shake our head at. But that's what they want you to feel.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I really believe that's what they want you to feel. And all of a sudden we're in the slowdown mode.
Right.
And wait a little bit longer for your service to come, and a little bit longer for this to come, mm-hmm. a little bit longer for that to come.
Mm-hmm.
Poor form. That's the wrong way to do business. We're not talking about those other things. We're talking about the way that they performed this
aspect of our relationship
on this interconnection.
Yep.
A very simple thing that was already authorized once.
I agree.
That had already been done once.
I agree.
I know you do.
That's why
it's just a poor way to do business.
I
I think if more towns, more people would be more forthcoming, instead of just talking about it at home, all the blankety blank.
Right.
But then they would, Sherry, can you ask Beth to write up something for us, please? Thank you.
Well, plus, if it had gone in and the contractor hadn't gone under,
it would be in there already.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Cause,
yeah. There's still.
Yeah.
Sherry, continue. I just feel terrible. I mean, because that's what they do. What's that?
I met with Rich Brenda and representatives from Ty and Bond last week to review the scope of services for the I&I study. They're going to do some preliminary data collection, but the project really won't kick off until March of 2017 during the rain season. That study's kind of driven by that, as you know. And then also to follow up on the OPEB, I talked to Susan, the treasurer, a little bit more about that project and the Bartholomew group that she's recommending. That is exempt from Chapter 30B because it's a trust fund.
I see.
So there's no requirement for procurement process. And also based on a value of $100,000, and if we charge 60 basis points for the annual charge would only be $600. Our trust fund amount right now, because we're just getting started, is right around 53, I believe. So it's probably half of that. The treasurer is the custodian of the funds, and what she'd like to do is to establish a trust committee as well. That would help oversee that process. That committee would be made up of the accountant, the treasurer, usually a member of the finance committee, a selectman, and myself. So we would like to proceed with that and get that set up.
Could we get to dabble in the stock market?
Remember that. Yeah. I remember that. Could I ask? Go ahead.
Dabble with Mohegan Sun.
No. Could I ask about a history of this Bartholomew group?
Oh, sure. Would you like to have them come in? And
I think it would make sense.
Yeah.
Only in that. It's not that I'm questioning the treasurer's judgment on this. No. On the contrary, but it is new to the town, and oftentimes these institutional decisions end up with long-term ramifications.
It's one of those topics that doesn't get a lot of visibility, but it's very, very important and could have a huge impact financially. Yeah. So.
Mm-hmm. Okay. That's it.
Okay. Thank you, Sherry. FY17 appointments. Are we ready? Reappointments?
Could I ask about the list?
These are ready? These are the lists?
We have a list.
Okay, Mr.
Two lists, I guess.
Yes, two pages.
All right.
I'm going to go through one name at a time. You ready?
Shoot.
Yeah. Now, do we want to do it as a
slate?
I think we've done this one as a slate before because of the length. Let's see. Do we have to do two because we have two sheets?
Okay. Two different motions.
Each other's committees.
Right. Okay, so I will make a motion for the slate for committees, boards, and commissions for the selectmen's appointment for 6/16/16.
Second for discussion. And if I could, the format I appreciate here quite a, I appreciate a great deal. I would like to know, these are open appointments for the upcoming year. I see some committees names are not here, meaning that their appointment is running through the upcoming year.
They're staggered terms, so
Got
these
it.
Are the ones that are up this
these
year
are all great,
only.
Great. We it's just been a long time coming. So yeah. No, but that's my only question. Thank you.
Okay, a motion made and seconded to appoint the committees and boards, and we're looking at 300th Anniversary Committee, Anti-Harassment Officer, Capital Improvement Planning Committee, Community Pathway Committee, Community Preservation Committee, Conservation, Constables, Economic Development Committee, Emergency Management Director, Energy Committee, Franklin County Bike Path, Franklin County Solid Waste, Franklin County Regional Planning Board, Hazardous Waste Coordinator, Historical Commission, Housing Committee, Network Electronic Resource Agent, Parking Clerk, Personnel Committee, Rec Committee, Registrars, Sunderland EPT, which is Emergency Preparation Team, Town Council, Veterans Memorial Oversight Committee, ZBA, ZBA Associate Membership, Selectmen Committees, for 2016. It's amazing how many people are involved, isn't it?
It is amazing. We're fortunate.
A motion made and seconded. Mm-hmm. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Okay. Next, David.
All right. I'll read the areas. How's that on this one?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, this is for the appointment for 6/16/16 for the employees. We've got accountant, administrative selectman's office for the administrative assistant, animal control officer, assessor's office, admin, board of health agent, housing agent, building commissioner, two assistant building inspectors, veterans graves, collector treasurer, assistant collector treasurer, payroll clerk, fire chief, assistant fire chief, highway department superintendent, fence viewer, tree warden, moth superintendent, that's all one. Highway department, we have a clerk, laborer, and then four temporary laborers, a plumbing and gas inspector, and for the police department, we have the clerk. Eight officers. Also, and each officer is also an alcohol enforcement agent and a sergeant, who's also the same. And four of those are part-time. Four are full-time, the rest part-time. Recreation coordinator, telecom technician, wire inspector, and wiring inspector alternate.
No.
For discussion, I would say probably two, so.
Were we okay to appoint the police right now? I thought I saw an email earlier.
Just hold off on that.
We should hold off on the police, right?
Yeah, they will continue with the... They'll continue their employment. It's not changing.
Right. So we shouldn't appoint them now, though.
We should not appoint them now.
So let me rescind that motion and then make a modified motion for everything except the police. That's on that sheet.
You could appoint a police clerk.
Okay.
Right? I think we can do the clerk.
We can do the clerk?
Yeah.
All right, I'll rescind that one. Everybody on the sheet, except the police, including the police clerk.
Second.
All right.
I followed that right through.
You just want to read the names next time?
Yeah, maybe, huh?
All right, here we go.
All right, we have a motion made, seconded.
Uh-huh.
To appoint all positions except for the police. And police is just a technical concern right now about not having a chief of police.
Correct.
Their employment's not ended. It's just the way the laws read and how you have to appoint.
The way the laws read, an officer in charge can't appoint the slate. And if we don't appoint them, they continue until a chief is there to appoint them.
Right.
It's pretty easy. They can't appoint themselves.
Can't appoint themselves.
Kind of makes sense.
Go figure.
Yep.
So all those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Sherry 3-0.
Can I make a motion for quieter camera service?
All right. Next up is the appropriation transfer from police department. Basically, what we're doing is they're looking for, where is that police here?
We have the $5,000 one for the police.
Amount requested $5,000, and they're taken from the police department expenses that have $16,720.
Mr. Chair, if I could ask.
Yep.
Are we allowed to transfer from wages to expenses?
What's that?
Are we allowed to transfer from wages to expenses? I seem to remember that was...
I thought not, but
I didn't think you could. I think you could go wages to wages, expenses to expenses.
Right, but you can cross categories.
I thought it was in I thought it was department. We'll figure it out.
Yeah, figure it out.
Clarification on that.
Yeah,
the accountant
figure it out.
Signed it, but I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
I thought you could do it within a budgetary thing.
So. Could be.
All right.
You just can't cross departments.
Right. Next up is the retirement notification.
There's another one here as well,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, for $5,000 for...
Medicare? Is that the one?
Yeah,
Medicare.
Yes. Right. Chapter 720 unemployment.
All right, so we're looking at taking $5,000 from unemployment, Chapter 720, and applying it to Medicare.
Motion to approve the transfer.
Second.
All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay, that happens. We have received a letter from Mr. Edwin Skrbiski.
This is, we received this on 5/23/16. That was to George, the highway superintendent. I, Edwin Skrbiski, are planning to retire on June 30th or earlier if medical issues become a problem.
Motion?
Motion.
I'll second.
Okay, we have a motion made and seconded to accept the retirement notification from Edward Skrbiski, who's been a member of our highway department for a few years. Most people don't know the amount of work that goes on every day in the highway department, never mind just the snow plowing. So Eddie, we appreciate all your years of service, and you will be missed, and we hope that you enjoy your retirement. All those in favor accepting, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
3-0. Jerry. Appointment of alternate building inspector, Thomas Quinlan.
Did we just do that on the slate? Didn't we just do that on the slate?
You know, that's a good point.
This is for probably the remainder of this year.
Oh, okay. Move to appoint Mr. Quinlan as alternate building inspector, as recommended by the building commissioner.
Second.
Motion made and seconded. All those in favor
aye.
Of the appointment of Mr. Quinlan as the alternate building inspector, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
For the remainder of this year,
yeah.
Fiscal year.
Yeah.
All right, anything more?
Mr. Chair, if it's probably with the board, we can vote this conditional upon, you know, approval of the transfer of funds. So we don't want to hold anything up.
Okay. We have a motion to...
This is appropriation transfer from police wages to a police expense for mobile data terminals.
As long as it's authorized through the town accountant, correct?
As long as it's an allowable transfer.
Yeah.
Okay. Second.
Motion made and seconded. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay with that one, Sherry? Okay, thank you. Anything else?
No, I think that's it. Motion to adjourn.
June 20th, we have the next Board of Selectmen's meeting, which would be here on June 20th. July 4th, the town offices are closed, which is our Independence Day observance. We have a motion to adjourn.
Second.
And seconded. Any further discussion? Camera people?
Oh, we're ready.
You ready? Earning your money tonight, aren't you?
Yeah,
the
4th and
5th.
Very
I would,
good.
Maybe
and seconded to adjourn. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Sherry, we will declare that is a unanimous vote, and we will call the Sunderland Board of Selectmen out of session on June 6th at 8:25, give or take a minute. I don't know that precision timepiece.
Plus or minus.
For error.
It's questionable sometimes.